So, let's go back and think about our money demand equation. And we derived it in the last video segment. We have the money demand is proportional to the price level times real GDP. And is negatively associated with this idea of the velocity of money. And you may be just a little bit confused here. What we're saying here is the demand for money is proportional to the price level, and that's going to look like a pretty weird demand curve. And one way of thinking about this is that the value of money is inversely proportional to the price level as represented by the CPI or GDP deflator. Because when the price level is high, it takes a lot of money to buy a certain amount of goods, so money is not very valuable. So high price level means money not valuable, or not as valuable, or a low price level means money is more valuable. So when I draw the supply and demand diagram for money, on the vertical axis, I'm not going to have the price level, but rather the value of money, because we're trying to measure the market for money. So the value or price of money needs to be on the vertical axis. And that, in turn, is going to be 1 over the price level. Okay, so if we do that, and we think about what this thing would look like, we would have this nice parabolic shape here. So this is the money demand curve. And then we think about the money supply, and the money supply is, in a modern economy, whatever the Fed says it is. And the intersection here is our predicted equilibrium value of money. And once we know our predicted equilibrium value of money, then we know what our predicted price level is. Let me go ahead and draw a bigger version and try to explain how we get to that equilibrium. Nice and big now. So we have value of money on this axis, and we know that that equals 1 over the price level. And we have quantity of money on the horizontal axis. And we've got the money supply right here. And I've drawn it as vertical under the assumption that the money supply just is what it is, and the Federal Reserve doesn't change the money supply in responses to changes in the price level. And that might or might not be a realistic way to think about what the Federal Reserve does, but we'll go ahead and think about that being the answer for now. Well, let's go ahead and think about what happens if the value of money starts really high, which is to say, if value of money high, we could equivalently say the price level is low. And at this point here, P people have more money in their checking account than they really want to hold in liquid form. So what they're potentially going to do is go out there and spend it. So, you know, they might have a target level in their checking account of $2,000, and they find themselves, say, with, so their target level here would be here. They have a target level of money in the checking account of $2,000, but there's actually, you know, $6,000 per person available in circulation. And so there's all this excess money sloshing around, so people are going to spend it. So there's an excess supply of money, because quantity supplied is out here, quantity demanded is right there. So excess supply of money. And so people engage in lots of spending. It could be by households. It could be also that they put it into investments, and then firms do a lot of investment spending. So it could be households, it could be firms. So what happens to prices when people engage in a lot of spending? Well, when people engage in a lot of spending, that's going to tend to push prices up. And remember, when prices go up, the value of money falls. So if we start up here, we're going to tend to go downwards until we reach this point of equilibrium. So we start high, we get pushed down to equilibrium, just like in a conventional demand and supply model. What if we start down here, where the value of money is low? So that's going to mean, that's equivalent to saying the price level is high. So in this situation, people want to hold this much money, but there's only this much money available. So it's like people want to hold $2,000 in their checking account, but there's only $1,000 per person available. So people are going to cut back on spending as much as they're able. And as people cut back on spending, that's going to cause prices to fall, because there's a fall in demand all across the economy. And when prices fall, of course, this term on the bottom here gets smaller, which means the overall term gets bigger, and so the value of money is going to rise. And so what happens then, say for instance, if we start here and then we have an increase in the money supply? Well, we change our equilibrium point. We had an equilibrium value of money here at first, and now we have an equilibrium value of money here. So the value of money falls, which is equivalent to saying that the price level rises. So essentially, this is our explanation for explaining why and how an increase in the money supply causes inflation. And we could potentially have a decrease as well.